Well, what do you think?
What do you think?
I think let's do it.
Let's do it. Let's do this thing.
All right, all right. Well, come on in and welcome to the 62nd ever Sunday Assembly in San Diego. My oh my, we're so glad we're here. We're going to have such a great day today. We have a fantastic speaker. I want to make sure before you get started, we let you know we have a media free zone. So if you do, we are digitally recording this event. So if you don't want to be participating in that, sit over in this side over here. And also we have the ability to watch children 1.5 up. So please feel free to bring the kids. And if nothing else, if you just want to have an hour to yourself away from the kids, just bring them. And now we have child care professionals who are quite good at what they do and have been here every single Sunday. Before we do anything else, we're gonna do what we usually do, which is start with the amazing Mr. Paul Svensson.
Okay, so what I'd like to do is teach you the chorus to this. Would you pop up to the chorus? You're gonna sing, doctor, doctor, give me the news. I got a bad case of loving you. No pill's gonna cure my ill. I've got a bad case of loving you. Right? Do it now. Singing, doctor, doctor, give me the news. I got a bad case of loving you. No pill's gonna kill my ill. I got a bad case of loving you. From a band. A hot summer night. I got a bad case of loving you. You guys sound pretty good. Let's stand up. You don't have to if you don't want to. Here we go. A pretty face won't make no pretty heart. Doctor, give me the news. I got a
Thank you, Paul, and the band.
Yes.
You all did a fantastic job.
I blew up my pick.
Well, welcome to Sunday Assembly. Sunday Assembly is a secular, non-religious community that meets monthly to hear great talks, to connect for community events, to sing silly songs, to have some snacks, but mostly we're here to celebrate together this one life that we know that we have. The motto for Sunday Assembly is live better, help often, and wonder more, and every Sunday Assembly has a theme, and the theme for this Sunday Assembly is perseverance. How many, by a show of hands, is it your first time to Sunday Assembly? Well, give those people a high five. Welcome. We're so glad you're here today to enjoy the June gloom in comfort and in this beautiful place with this lovely view. It's a gorgeous day. And happy Father's Day for those of you that's applicable. And we do a thing we call Life Happens, which is us sharing things out of our life. And I have a few of those today. One of them, it says, it's my birthday today. Shh, don't tell anyone. So that's going to be a big celebration that I just can't help myself. That happens to be my best friend, by the way. Just my wife. I said I wouldn't do that, but I couldn't help myself. My son Nathan had a stroke and is in hospital, and prayers are welcome, good vibes, and good thoughts. So we will send those out to Nathan for a speedy recovery. Syria performed in her school's spoken word festival to thunderous applause. Thunderous applause. Let's have some thunderous applause for Syria. That's two things I wasn't supposed to say today, apparently. So Paul is going to be a grandfather for the first time. So happy Grandfather's Day. His daughter is scheduled. What's the name? Oh, the package. I thought that was the name of the new child. That's funny. I didn't know you named them that early. Especially it's going to arrive in October. I said, we'll just name it now. So, package is a good name. We also have Help Happen, so things that we're doing in the community, some things coming up. I believe Alexis will be doing that, telling us what's going on in the community. Come on up, Alexis.
Short Alexis, here we go. Hi, so I want to talk to you a little bit this morning about hunger. There are 821 million hungry people in the world, according to a United Nations poll from 2016. America boasts 40 million of those people. So that's a lot of hungry people in one of the richest countries in the world who also boasts having the most billionaires. Of the hungry people in the world, most are women and children, 60%. These are United Nations numbers. We have some local numbers, too. So worldwide, 1 in 9 people are hungry. Food insecurity is defined as something that where you skip a meal, or you make soup stretch longer, or you feed your kids but not yourself. In the world, that's 1 in 9 people. Here in San Diego, it is 1 in 7. That is pretty high. Come on, billionaires. Sunday Assembly San Diego is trying to help with that particular problem. What we're doing is we are making sandwiches on the street as individuals. See, we don't need a permit, individuals. And going around and handing them to people directly, along with other toiletries, fresh fruit, anything you can eat without having good teeth. Another big issue on the street. Homelessness numbers have risen here in San Diego, especially in California overall, if you include LA County, and all over the United States. For another thing Sunday Assembly is trying to do is we are going to partner with Produce Good and pick up extra food left over from farmers markets. They're crop picking kind of ends next month, so we'll probably pick that up next year. But there's also harvest crops, which does it year-round. We also pack food boxes with Sunshine Sarah over there once a month. I believe we're taking a month off, but to help put food boxes together for those who need them. I know this feels to me, I've sat in on city council meetings where I can't help but think, and those of you in the helping profession, forgive me, I know this is such an overused analogy, but the story of the beach and the sea stars, where there's a unnaturally high tide, and all these sea stars get thrust upon the beach, and then the tide recedes, and the sea stars are drying and dying. And one small child goes out, and the child, in a panic, thrusts all the sea stars back into the ocean. And a cynical adult approaches the child and says, "You're not gonna do any good, it's hopeless, there's too many. What good are you gonna do?" And the child says, "It matters to this one," and chucks that sea star back into the sea, where it lives out its life, or it gets a meal. And you and I are both the child and the adult. We can do this. It seems hopeless, but let's fix things for just one more person. If you'd like to join us, we do a lot in this specific area. We also do other things. But please let me know, approach us, approach anyone in a Sunday Assembly shirt. We would be happy to help you come on board, learn more about the problem, and how you personally can help. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We have a reading today. It's To Be of Use by Margie Piercy, and our reader is Jan McCown.
To Be of Use by Marge Piercy. The people I love the best jump into work head first without dallying in the shallows and swim off with sure strokes almost out of sight. They seem to become natives of that element, the black sleek heads of seals bouncing like half-submerged balls. I love people who harness themselves, an ox to a heavy cart, who pull like water buffalo with massive patience, who strain in the mud and the muck to move things forward, who do what has to be done again and again. I want to be with people who submerge in the task, who go into the fields to harvest and work in a row and pass the bags along, who are not parlor generals and field deserters, but move in a common rhythm when the food must come in or the fire must be put out. The work of the world is common as mud. Botched, it smears the hands, crumbles to dust. But the thing worth doing well done has a shape that satisfies, clean and evident. Greek amphoras for wine or oil, Hopi vases that held corn are put in museums, but you know they were made to be used. The pitcher cries for water to carry, and a person for work that is real.
Thank you, Jen. So there's a little blurb in your program about our speakers today, Dr. Steffanie Strathdee and Dr. Thomas Patterson. I'm so excited to have them here. They wrote this book together. Highly recommend it. It's a fantastic read. Lots of really good information in here, and just delightful. Thank you for being here. Please welcome Steffanie Strathdee.
Hi, everybody. Thank you very much. So we're going to give a presentation. It's a real story about how our professional and personal lives collided in a crazy way. We will be having our book on sale if anybody is interested in more details, but I'm going to cram the story into 20 minutes. So our story began in November of 2015. Over Thanksgiving, we typically go away, and we were in Egypt on vacation, and Tom was as fit as a fiddle. I mean, he was a little overweight, but, you know, that was about it, and here he is hamming it up in Egypt. We were parked on a ship in Luxor across from the Valley of the Kings and had this glorious meal on top of the cruise ship. The next day we were supposed to see King Tut's tomb and then head home. And Tom got violently ill. I mean, he was throwing up all night, and I just figured maybe he ate a bad mussel or something, because he usually eats more than me. And he just kept rolfing, and it was like, you know, horrible. And the next day I called a doctor to the ship, and the doctor gave him some IV antibiotics and some fluids and said, you know, I think he'll be right as rain in a couple hours. And he wasn't. Actually, he got worse and started complaining of back pain. Well, I'm an infectious disease epidemiologist by training, but I don't have a medical degree. And I started to Google some of his symptoms and realized, okay, we weren't looking at food poisoning. We were looking maybe at something more serious, maybe pancreatitis, an inflammation of the pancreas. So I called the doctor back to the ship against Tom's screams, and the doctor said he's going into shock. And I said, so am I. And there was no hospital in Luxor, so they took him to a clinic. And luckily, they did have a CT, and so they took him to a CT scan the next day. And there, they got scared, and they didn't tell us what they saw. But they did make it easier for us to get him medevaced out of there, because up until this point, they thought that they could handle it. Thankfully, for travel insurance, $38 paid for 7 ambulances and 2 Learjets to get him home. But before we could even get him home, like, you know, we had to stop off in Germany because he was too sick to bring him all the way back. And so here he is being loaded onto this Learjet, which was not glamorous in any stretch of the way. And when we got him to Germany, he was diagnosed with a superbug inside this abscess in his abdomen that had been caused by a gallstone that stuck in his bile duct and caused all this fluid to back up. So he had this giant abscess called a pseudocyst, and it was a perfect apartment building for this superbug to move into. Now, this particular superbug is a nasty one. A superbug basically is a bacteria that's resistant to multiple antibiotics. And this one's name is Acinetobacter baumannii. And the German doctor who pronounced it, I couldn't kind of catch it. When he wrote it down, I went, I vaguely remember this. I used to streak this bacteria on my Petri dish when I was a student back in the 1980s, and we didn't need anything fancy back then, just a lab coat and gloves, and how on earth is this now a superbug? And not only that, a few months later, the World Health Organization declared this as the number one superbug out of 12 that are a threat to human health around the world. Well, could talk about this for a whole other hour, but basically, this is an organism that is really like a bacterial kleptomaniac. It's really good at stealing antimicrobial resistance genes from other bacteria. And it's called Arachibacter for short, because so many veterans come back from the Middle East with this bug. And so, just like the song we started out with, there was no pill that was going to cure Tom's ill. We got what's called an antibiogram, which is basically the antibiotic susceptibility profile. And even though you may not speak or read German, it doesn't take a brain surgeon to see all of those R's, which stand for resistance. So basically, right off the top, his organism was resistant to 15 different antibiotics, and it was only partially sensitive to 3. And over those next few weeks, it acquired resistance to even those last 3. So by the time he got back to San Diego in another Learjet, he was here at the UC San Diego, what was then the Thornton ICU. It's now the Jacobs Medical Center. There was nothing left in modern medicine's arsenal that could kill it. He was basically dying. He was too weak to have an operation to take this cyst out, so they basically stuck these catheters in his abdomen to try to drain off the infected fluid and hope that his body could come strong enough to fight it. And one day, he sat up in bed, because he was actually doing okay for a little while. Their strategy was working. But one of those internal drains slipped, and it poured all that infected fluid into his abdomen and in his bloodstream. And right in front of me, he went into septic shock. Now, just so you know, septic shock is your body's overreaction to a pathogen that usually hits the bloodstream. And what it looks like when you see it is a major drop in blood pressure, heart rate goes through the roof, and the respiration rate, like breathing, panting very hard, and people are usually sweating profusely or urinating profusely. And in Tom's case, all of this infected fluid was pouring into these ostomy bags and like by the liter right in front of us. And this is all happening so quickly that, you know, we just knew that something was wrong. And he started to shake, and that's called rigors. And he shaked so much that the bed frame hit the wall. And luckily, there was a doctor and a nurse right there. And he was sent right back to the ICU, and he was put in a medically induced coma. And from that moment on, he started to die a little more each day. It was horrible. And this photo was taken by my stepdaughter, Carly, who's here, right after the doctors told us that he wasn't going to make it. And it was just horrible. These are our own, like, colleagues, basically. And they were having a hard time with this, too. And Tom was in a deep coma by now. This was not medically induced, a real coma. And some days his eyebrows would be twitching a little bit. And I thought to myself, you know, I really want him to live, but I don't know what he wants right now. Even though we've done our wills and have power of attorney and everything, he basically told me years before that, hey, you know, if I'm brain dead and I'm lying there in a coma, like, unplug me, because I don't want to live if I'm brain dead. But his brain was alive. It was his body that was dying, and I didn't know what he would want me to do. So I thought to myself, what should I do? What do I think he wants? And I thought, well, why don't I ask him? Even though he's in a coma, I remember there's research saying that people can hear, potentially. And so I took it upon myself to ask him this one particular day. I said, honey, I know you're fighting really hard and you're tired. You've been months in the hospital now. I mean, this is now February of 2016. And I said, I want to grow old with you. But I need to know what you want. It would be too selfish of me to keep you alive for my sake. If you want to live, please squeeze my hand. And I'll leave no stone unturned. So I waited, and he squeezed my hand. It took about a minute, but he squeezed hard. There was no mistaking what he wanted. And I pumped my fist into the air with my little gloved hand, and I said, great, but oh shit, what am I gonna do now, right? Because, like, how am I gonna over, you know, do what, like, the doctors have already done, and I don't know how I'm gonna do this. But I went home, and I did what anybody would do. I Googled it. Well, I mean, Google for scientists is something called PubMed that many of you may be familiar with. It's developed by the National Library of Medicine. And I went and I entered words like Acinetobacter baumannii and multidrug resistance, alternative therapies, and I came up with this paper. And buried in this paper was something called phage therapy or bacteriophage therapy. Now, I remembered vaguely what bacteriophage were. These are viruses that have naturally evolved to attack bacteria. They're actually the oldest and most populous organism on the planet. There's 10 million, trillion, trillion phages out there. This is an electron micrograph that's showing stained phages in green attacking a bacterial cell that's stained in orange. And this is, like, magnified about 100,000 times. So they look a little bit like lunar landers or spiders from outer space. And so basically these phages have to be matched to a specific bacteria in order for them to work. And there was a guy who had discovered phages 100 years ago. And I thought, well, could we use phages to cure Tom? Because this guy had actually gone and used these phages to treat people with bacterial infections. And it was being used regularly in the former Soviet Union, but just not in the United States, where it was considered experimental. So I wrote Tom's doctors, and the head of infectious diseases said, well, what an interesting and intriguing idea. If you can find phages that can match his organism, then, you know, I'll call the FDA and get permission, because it's an experimental treatment. So the next thing we had to do was find the phages. Well, that seemed like a pretty hard thing to do. But I took this picture of Tom. One of our students gave us this shirt, I Survived Arachobacter, and Tom was not surviving at this point at all. He was on life support. He was on a ventilator to keep his lungs working. He was on three different pressors to keep his heart pumping. And I wrote total strangers, who I found their information on the internet, again, through the PubMed. And I said, please, please help me. My husband is dying of a superbug, and I can tell from your work that you were studying phages. And one guy wrote me back, Dr. Rye Young from Texas A&M, total stranger. And he said, if you send me this bacterial isolate, I will turn my lab into a command center and look for phages to match his organism. And he did. In fact, one of his graduate students slept in the laboratory for a couple weeks and found some phages. So then Chip Schooley, the head of infectious diseases at UC San Diego, contacts the FDA and expects to tell them all about phage therapy and what it was, but they knew all about it. They were actually looking and hoping for a case like Tom's where we would be able to, you know, collect data for them to show that it worked. And they said, there's a lab that you guys might not know about. And, you know, Chip says, well, Stephanie's looked really hard. I think she's got them all. And they said, no. The FDA says, we can turn you on to another lab. It's the Navy and the Army, the military of the U.S. It's like, because they're studying phages because of this Arachobacter. So they put us in touch with this guy, Lieutenant Commander Theron Hamilton, on the right part of this slide, who looks like Tom Cruise, doesn't he, because of the rescue. And he put his team to work, including a fellow by the name of Biswajit Biswas, who was nicknamed the Phage Whisperer. I'm skipping ahead in the chapters here, but 3 weeks later, from my email to this moment, we all of a sudden now have two cocktails of phages that were prepared, purified, all ready to go. And the other thing you have to know along the way is that some of these phages were directly sourced from environmental sources. And what I mean by that, anybody who read the book know what I'm talking about? Poop, that's right, sewage. Because wherever you want to find phages, you go where there's a lot of bacteria. So barnyard waste, sewage, treatment facilities. So I was just dying to tell Tom. I said, wake up, we're going to pump you full of shit. But anyway, we had some serious moments, but we talked to him a lot. Carly was singing her guitar, playing her guitar, and you know, his other daughter was reading him from bird books. And this is what Tom looked like the day that we administered the phage therapy, March 15th of 2016. He's full of all these tubes and pincushions, and oh, it just looks like a mess. And here's the day that we administered the phages. They were first put in the catheters in his abdomen because that was close to the source of the infection. But we were advised that we better treat him intravenously because he's fully colonized. Remember, this organism was dumped into his whole body. So that was part of the innovation here because we could have killed him, right? Well, we injected over a billion viruses per dose into his bloodstream, and his body could have identified it as foreign, and he could have died. But we knew that he was going to die anyway. So his daughters gave me permission for this bold, crazy idea. And 3 days later, he woke up, lifted his head off the pillow, and kissed his father's hand. And, you know, kissed his daughter's hand, sorry. I'm thinking of Father's Day. He's here in the front row. You're going to hear from him in a few minutes. But needless to say, everybody in the ICU just, like, couldn't believe it. We were told that this is like, you know, the end of a football game where you've got 1 minute left and the quarterback is blindfolded throwing a 100-yard ball down the field, and it worked. The Hail Mary pass, that chapter is called. So Tom had a long recovery because he'd lost 100 pounds, all of his muscle mass. There's Carly with him sitting outside of the hospital. He was discharged in August of 2016. And, you know, you would think that the story ends there, but no. In fact, here's Tom's bacteria being attacked by phages, okay? This is actually, it's in our book. We have all of these photos because when the publisher had people read it, they said that they thought it was fiction. They couldn't believe it, so we have photos to prove it. So this is a micrograph taken by the Department of Homeland Security, believe it or not. The story went viral in a big way, and in a good way, once the case was presented publicly. All over the world, people started calling us for help, and because total strangers had stepped up to help me, I felt like they're looking for phage therapy for their loved ones who are fighting superbug infections, so I have to do something. So luckily, the chancellor at UC San Diego, after seeing this, because we'd treated six other patients other than Tom's, and most successfully, some were too late in the course of their infection to save their lives, but two of them are pictured there on this slide with permission. The chancellor gave us funding to launch the first dedicated phage therapy center in North America called IPATH, the Center for Innovative Phage Applications and Therapeutics. And I'm the co-director along with Dr. Schooley, who was the protocol chair who oversaw Tom's case. And we've consulted on cases all over the world and saved dozens of lives, so we think this has the potential to save millions. But what we want to do now is take phage therapy into clinical trials because these N of ones are not enough to get the FDA to decide to license it. So we're launching our first clinical trial later this year, and we're very excited about that. But one of the most moving stories that I can share with you before I end is that the first genetically modified phage cocktail was used to successfully treat a girl with cystic fibrosis who had a superbug infection called Mycobacterium abscessus. It's in the same genus as tuberculosis. Now, that's important because this is the first human being to be treated with a Mycobacterium infection with phage therapy, and it worked. But also, she was treated intravenously based on Tom's case, even though, you know, everybody's worried about whether or not she's going to die. But they knew that she was going to die anyway. She was already in hospice. And this case is also the first genetically modified phage cocktail to be used in a human being. So two world firsts. It was published in Nature Medicine in May. And I was put in touch with the mom and the patient, Isabel, who gave me permission to tell her story today. And she wrote me and said, when are you coming to visit? I'll make cupcakes. I mean, blow me down. It's just incredible. So she's now learning to drive. She's just taken her A-level exams, and, you know, we share kitten pictures on Facebook. So it's just incredible that saving the life of one person has rippled effect through the world and is now saving others. And we're very blessed for that. We feel that ours is a story of privilege because so many people with superbug infections don't have the resources we have. So that's why we're trying to take our story to the world and scale this up because it has the potential to save many lives. And that's why we wrote our book, The Perfect Predator. I'll just end there. And if there's time for questions later, we're going to be sticking around. And we'll be selling our book in the back for $15. Thank you.
More remarkable than your work here is that you were able to summarize your book. It's amazing. That's there's so much in this book. I highly recommend getting it and reading it. We do a personal moment. Kristen's going to announce that. So we separated Tom from Steph. Kristen?
So today we get to hear from Tom, but in the coming months, as usual, we want to hear from some of you. We all have a story or two or seven inside us. And by sharing our stories with each other, we build community. And we've put out the, you know, request for stories for personal moment, for the personal moment section. And I was thinking, well, it might be easier for you to think of a story that you might want to tell if you had a prompt. So here's two completely different prompts. And if this gets your mind flowing about one of your experiences, come talk with me afterwards, or really any of those of us that you've seen up here. So here's the first one. Is there something that you used to be terrible at that now you're pretty good at? How did you or the situation change? And then, two, tell us about your first kiss. So, if you'd like to share, come see me afterwards. And then in the coming months, we can help you shape that story. And also, if you don't want to tell it personally, we can get someone else to read it. So get your juices flowing, something you were terrible at and are now good at, or your first kiss, or anything else for that matter. But this is just two possibilities.
Hi there. Thanks for having me. So you can tell I live, so I ruined the book for you. Well, I've got a few messages for you about this, my experience. First, the obvious one that I think most of you probably recognize is, I chose wisely. Make sure you plan ahead before you get ill. But I think in a more general way, I think a message for everyone is, advocate for people in the hospital, no matter whether they're in a coma or not. Because when you're in a coma, you're not a loaf of bread. You can hear. I could hear what was going on. But as you will see if you read the book, I wasn't exactly, shall we say, sane during my coma, which lasted for on and off. I wasn't in a pure coma for the entire time, but over 3 months I was in a coma of the 9 months I was in the hospital. And so, for example, when Steffanie said, squeeze my hand, I was a snake. Yeah, really. And I'm telling you, this isn't like some drug craze thing. In my brain right now, as I think back, I can tell you what it is to be a snake. And as a snake, it's a little difficult to squeeze somebody's hand because you don't have hands. So I had to think, and it took me a little bit to figure out, I need to wrap my body around her hand and squeeze that to let her know that I do hear her. So, as you will see, there's a lot of other crazy experiences throughout that I went through. Adventures, shall we say. I'd like to say they were fun. They weren't. It was it wasn't a great time. However, I lost 100 pounds. So this is a diet for you all. It's called the super diet from Tom, but I don't think you're going to be buying this diet. It's a little expensive, to say the least. But people ask me, how do you make it through 9 months in the hospital? How do you do that? How do you survive? Well, first off, you don't take it day by day. You take it moment by moment. And you roll with the punches because stuff happens, as we say. I'll take it literally, it shit happens. And when you're in the situation I was, you'd start to get better and suddenly things would go awry. You don't worry about what's happened in the past. That just depresses you. You don't worry about the future because that just makes you anxious. So you live in the present, you live for the moment. That's the first thing I would tell you. But I also think what's really important to know is, because I could hear and because I wasn't in a coma the entire time, I was able to survive because of the love of my family and friends, the care that they took. Having people talk to me, when somebody touched me, it was like an electric shock through my body. And to have that support was what made my survival possible. The other part of it is that most people who go into a coma come out of it cognitively impaired. Now, you might argue that I'm cognitively impaired. I'm going to argue with you. I think I'm done okay. And I think that's because people stimulated me along the way. They kept talking to me, playing music, reading to me, touching. And I don't think everybody has that privilege. So if you have that opportunity to support somebody that's in the hospital, please do. But I can tell you too, coming out of this, it isn't as easy as you might think. It's not like waking up in the movies where you kind of go, wow, great, let's go out and dance, let's have a steak. It takes about 5 times as long to recuperate as it does time in the hospital. So I'm 3 years out, I have another year to go before I'm supposedly completely recovered from this. So it is a long period of time to recover from something like this. But the other part of it is, it's not just physical, it's psychological. Everybody in my family and came out with PTSD. You're gonna be, and I had PTSD. So you need to support people and understand that there's a lot of emotion involved in this. There's guilt. You know, I mean, I feel guilty that I put my family through this. Naturally, I didn't go over there to Egypt looking for a superbug, but having to put your entire family through this kind of stress, you can't help but feel really guilty about it. So I would say I'm very, very privileged, obviously, just to be standing in front of you today. I'm hopeful that phage therapy is really going to be the answer to this looming problem. By 2050, it's going to kill more people than than climate change, superbugs. So, I mean, it's an incredible problem. And I'm privileged to maybe be the kind of the starting point for a solution. But I'm not the absolute answer. And so I stand before you as evidence-based hope. And with that, I'll end. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Paul Svensson.
Let's try and sing this together.
When you're weary, small, when tears are in
you're down and out. When you're on the street.
Thank you, Paul. That was lovely. I'm going to change up the order in the program just a bit because I don't know about you, but these days it seems like my emotions are just right under the surface. Seems like a perfect time for a moment of silence. Our theme for today is perseverance. And perseverance is persistence in doing something that is difficult. And we'll talk about that difficult something in just a little bit. About 100 miles east of here, just before you hit the desert floor in the mountains, there's a place, it's an 11-mile-long canyon called Carrizo Gorge. And in Carrizo Gorge, there's an area called Goat Canyon. And in a Goat Canyon, there is the longest curved wooden train trestle in the world, right here in East County. And I've always been fascinated by this train trestle and this area. My father grew up in the desert, and we spent a lot of time there. And I've been fascinated with the desert and its significance in San Diego County history. So I was invited by this fellow named George Copenhaver, who is a geologist, to go explore the area. And so, of course, I jumped at the chance. George had just written a book on Carrizo Gorge, the flora, the fauna, the geology, of course, and the history of the area. And he, so much so was he infatuated with the area, he called himself Carrizo George. So Carrizo George and I, you can't drive to the train trestle. You have to hike in. Park in Montero Palms, and he and I set off early in the morning. It's a really hardy hike. I have a couple thousand feet up over the mountains and then down into the canyon. And what would have been just a hardy hike with a neat thing to see at the end turned into this amazing experience for me because he narrated everything all the way through. And it just brought this whole desert to life. I learned about the volcanic plumes and the ancient seabeds with the coral and oyster reefs and this beautiful granite that was polished pink and the tourmaline that was mined in the area and the carrizo is a bush that's down in the bottom of the canyon. It's a local name for the shrub that's there that the original Americans, the Kumeyaay, used to make their baskets. And the history of the railway, it was built in 1912. It was funded largely by Spreckles, who built Spreckles Theater and many things downtown. He's a sugar magnate. And it was extant all the way till 1932, and there was an earthquake that damaged tunnel number 15. And it was pushed askew, and it was no longer usable as a train tunnel. So in a year, they built this amazing wooden trestle to bypass the train tunnel. And the line was, it was the San Diego, Arizona railway line. It was in use all the way till the 1970s. Flood happened, it got flooded out, and they rebuilt it, and they used it till the 90s. Another flood, and at the time we were there, this is 2004, they were just rebuilding the train trestle, the tracks again. They took the train and they moved it as far as they could to where there was sand covering the tracks. And then they took the sand, they put it on the train, and they took the sand back to the city and they sold the sand to pay for the train getting the sand. It was just amazing. And we walked across the trestle, and the trestle is 1,100 feet in the air, and it's super neat to walk across. It just feels kind of scary walking across and seeing the ground in between the slats. And we walked into the tunnel on the other side, and we had cheese and ham and crackers. It was just an amazing day, and we stayed there too long, and we walked back in the dark, and it was super scary, but it was just a fantastic day. And I think when you have these things where you know the history or the background or the little pieces of information, it just makes the world a more amazing place. And we can learn this from other people. We can learn it from books. I learned a great deal from the book here about phages and viruses and bacterias and MRSA. And oh my gosh, I'm super scared now. And I also, but it's fantastic. And I know what you did on Valentine's Day in 2016, I think it was. So it's in the book. Very, very good read. But I feel richer. And Tom, just what you were explaining about helping. When somebody's in a coma in the hospital, that's something I didn't know before. And that's a really good experience. I feel richer for having known these things. And we can learn from people, we can learn from books, and we can learn from school. You never regret your education or the things you learn there. I went to college. I got a summer job right after I finished college at a store, and 36 years and 11 months later, I'm still working at the store. So I'm not using my college education. As a matter of fact, I'm working at the same store I started. I went through the whole company, and now I'm right back where I started 37 years ago. I don't regret my education because I use critical thinking in a way that I may not have before. I get people's arcane jokes, although I missed your epidemiologist joke earlier, but now I'm smarter, so I learned from you. And you just don't regret your education and the things you learn. But, you know, we don't always learn books or people teaching us. We learn from other people. We learn from life. We learn from the people around us, and we should. This is where persistent comes in, to persistent perseverance, to ask questions, to be persistent about learning, to always be curious, to try new things and to listen to new ideas and to embrace other cultures and try food you never tried before and listen to music that's unfamiliar to you. And especially to try to put yourself in someone else's place, to walk in their shoes, to try to understand somebody in a way of what their experience of this life is. And to not just listen to the words that they say, but the things that they don't say. To listen in a way that you're that lets them know you're not trying to impose your idea on them, or you're not trying to let them know who you are, but really seek to understand someone else. I think it's an amazing, enriching thing to be able to do that. I think it's important to have empathy with other people. And it just makes the world a richer place for us. But not all the learning is this. I mean, there is also emotional learning. There's intellectual learning and there's emotional learning. And intellectually, you might have found the person that you're going to spend the rest of your life with, and you know they love you, and intellectually, you know you love them, and you know they accept you, and you know that you trust them and they trust you. But when you emotionally know that someone loves you for your fallacies and your flaws and your talents and your ugliness and your beauty, when you know they love you, it's an amazing thing when you have that. We learn emotionally. I met this person 23 years ago that grew up in my house for 18 years, and I learned so much about myself being a parent to this person. He hasn't called me for Father's Day yet, but he will, I'm sure. I worked with this, I learned from my addiction. I learned about my weakness, and I learned about my strength from my sobriety. I learned, I worked with this woman who was, in the last few months of her life, she was still working. She was facing cancer. She was she wore a wig to cover her hair loss. And every day when I'd see her, I'd ask how she was. And she'd say, just fine. Just fine. She'd say, just fine, like she was just fine. And then she would ask me how I was. Like she was really concerned that I was doing okay. I learned so much from that. I learned about grace. And I hope that I have that same grace if I'm ever in that same situation. I think it's really important for us to learn, to be persistent about that, to be curious. Because if we don't, if we only do things that we're familiar with, if we only do things that we know and be with people that believe the same thing that we do only, then people who are different from us become scary. And when people become scary, you ensconce yourself more in the things that are familiar. And when you do that, you're making all the whole world that's different. You do that for safety, but you're making everyone unsafe around you. Now, having said that, it's important to have boundaries. It's important. You're the one that gets to decide what's safe, who you talk to. Sometimes you have to cut people out of your life. People that don't accept you, sometimes that happens. People that you don't agree with, sometimes for your own sanity, you have to do that. You have to have boundaries. It's a good thing to have boundaries. But I think it's also really important to stick your toe in the water sometimes, just to see how it is, because it might be perfect. Thank you. So if you're making an announcement, if you would come on up, we'd love to have you up here. Announcers, and oh, let's see, what's the first one? Oh, yes. While people are coming up, I meant to ask for money. That is just so callous, Laura. I can't believe you're doing that as the treasurer of Sunday Assembly and Sunday Assembly in America. This is entirely run by volunteers. People work really hard here. We have a board of 11 people that support the Sunday Assembly. Entirely volunteer. They volunteer their time, and these are highly professional people that do a fantastic job. The only way we are able to do this is with your funding. So what we really appreciate is a reoccurring donation in any amount. That's what really helps us to know how much money we have coming in every month and pay for this lovely facility with this fantastic view and do some of the things that we do, some of the things that are coming up. Like, all right, the summer solstice shindig. So this is a really low-key event. We're asking you to bring a dish. We'll provide. There's a grill there. It's a park in Chula Vista. We have gazebo rented. We'll have ice there. So if you want to bring beverages, you can put there. Alcohol is permitted. One of the reasons I chose this specific park, although I don't drink myself, but I like people to have a good time if they want to. And there's a playground there. It's a lovely park. We'd love to have you. So 3 p.m. at Hilltop Park. It's going to go until about 8 o'clock. It's just the day after the solstice, or it's the first full day of summer. So it should be a nice long day and a fun time. So we hope that we see you there. And should I ask for money again while Lynn's coming up? No.
Coffee, conversation, and optional crafts. We're going to do this every fourth Sunday, and it's going to be at the Panera Bread at Liberty Station. Show up for conversation. If you are so inclined, bring some handiwork.
So the San Diego Pride Parade and Festival is less than a month away on July 13th and 14th, and we need you to come and join us for this event, and we need volunteers. You can help with pre-event preparations, setting up for the parade or the festival, marching or riding with us in the parade, or staffing our booth. This year's event is commemorating the 50-year anniversary of the Stonewall Uprising and the movement for LGBT+ rights that has followed. San Diego's Pride event is one of the largest in the country, and we always have a great time. So I hope you will come and enjoy it with us. There's a sign-up sheet at the back if you want to join us, and it's right in front of the calendar. Or see me if you have any questions. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lewis. This month, we are going camping at Palomar Mountain. That's the mountain up there with the observatory and the lake and everything. So we're going to speak some Greek around the campfire and then go for a hike. Look for you to join us. Check us out on Meetup and Eventbrite.
All right, thank you very much. I hope we see you, because the biggest part of this is community and hanging out together. Oh, this is a fun one, Paul.
Another heavy song.
Yes.
Let's all get up and stretch our legs a little. Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad. Others make you want to swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, come on, grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best.
See you back here the third Sunday of July, which is the 50th anniversary of the men landing on the moon. We'll have the ex-docent from the Aerospace Museum, Gordon Perman, will be talking about drones. Please enjoy some snacks, but most of all, enjoy talking to each other.